Okay, we're in the shop. We've got the back end of the Orenda 14. It is a little rusty. We're gonna fix that. That's what we do here. We fix things. And the title of today's video could be Turbine Blades, what holds them in? Or what I was thinking is, why are the locking tabs, the things that lock the turbine blades in, so small? So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna remove a couple blades to help explain why. First of all, this Orenda 14 has locking strips that look like that. That little thing there. We'll show a close-up of that in a minute. Next door, there's some hammering going on. And we're gonna pull this blade out, if I can get it out. There we go. Okay, so we're gonna show the fir tree of that. Close up, just hang on. We're gonna show the procedure here. These little cubes, cube-like things, they're baffles. They prevent air from going between the blades below the base. So the base basically forms the inner wall of the gas path, if you will. So nothing wants to get around there, because any air that goes through here is wasted. The power that it has is being wasted. So what I've done with these lock tabs, actually we're going to show a close-up of that. Hang on, just hang on. These tabs have already been started, so I'm going to start with a fresh one. This is an untouched, untested, unmolested lock tab, and we're going to take this turbine blade out. So we've got our detabber, which is a sort of a chisel shaped thing, not too sharp, not too dull. We're going to start this. Start it like that. Use our handy aluminum block to flatten it right out. These are not going to be reused, but there's no sense in destroying things. Now I need something. I want to demonstrate that if I pull on this blade, it's going nowhere. I could tow a truck with this. There's no way if I pull on this. I can beat on it, hammer on it up here, even in the middle of its span. Let's see, can I get in there? There's no way. I've got to get it right behind the fir tree mount, so I'm sort of pulling straight on it and not putting any leverage to make it rock or cock in the slots. No rocking and cocking in the slots. So I take this handy tool, which is meant for radiator hoses or whatever, but it allows me to reach in behind, and it's strong. It's made of tool steel. So I just get in there and try to pull on this thing right in the center. Oh, got the wrong blade. Let's do that, and it's going to cooperate. Yes, look at that. It pulls out. It's kind of sticky because it's rusty, but the fir tree is a very closely fit machined, actually I think it's ground into the disc. It might even be ground into the base of the blade, but they're a very close fit. There we go. So if you push in the center, if I push from the other side, right in the center, they will slide out. Sometimes it takes a bit of rocking and rolling. There we go. And it comes out rather elegantly without too much force. No beating and smashing. These are a little bit sticky. But if you apply force here or up here, then it will rock and lock itself into that slot. So during operation, there's a great deal of force this way on the blades, and because it's averaged from up here to down there, the force can be basically mathematically summarized or modeled as if it's in one point right there. There's the point of force, here's the point of mounting, so that would cause a torque arm, a lever arm, a moment arm to cause it to want to rotate in the slot. And we've seen with any rotational force, if I pull back here, the blade is going nowhere, even if I take our little handy aluminum block and we bend the lock tab out of the way. There's no way this blade's gonna move. Let's see, we'll use our handy tool up here a bit. I'm pulling with about 40 pounds of force right now. About 20 pounds of force, whatever. And down here, let's pull with one or two. Let's see, is it loose? It's loose. It should start to move. There, with, what was that, five? A couple, not much. Now there is rust in there, it is sticky. It's not perfect. We're gonna clean all that up, make it beautiful. But that rearward force, even if the lock pin wasn't there, is never gonna cause the blade to move. And the rearward force happens as soon as the engine starts burning fuel. Before it starts burning fuel, when it's starting, there's really not a whole lot of force in these blades, except for in this direction. Centripetally or centrifugally, however you want to call it, it's the tendency of the circular path that the blade mount is traveling because of the wheel to diverge from the natural path the blade wants to follow, which is tangential. So you could call it centripetal force is what pulls it in towards the center of the wheel, applied by the mass and the beautiful metal of the wheel. Or you could call it, I guess, centrifugal force, which is the apparent force of it wanting to pull out. But that's just the blade wanting to travel in a straight line rather than being pulled constantly downward towards the center of the wheel. Whatever, it causes a force this way, which locks the fir tree together. And that force exceeds any sliding forces as soon as you get, I don't know, 50, 60 RPM. And starting RPM for this thing is 900. So by the time you get some axial forces on the blade, it's more than locked up due to the centrifugal effect. So why do we even have blade locks? Why? Well, the only time the blades can move is when it's sitting there like this, and if the engine is being moved around or rattled or shipped on a truck or whatever, they could possibly slide in their mounts. And so over years or decades of service, they would start to move. But these little things here, they basically keep the blades from rattling around while it's in the shop or while it's in storage or while it's sitting at rest. The blade locks do not actually have to be there for engine operation. Okay, we're in the storage facility here for all the retired and stuff that's been put out to pasture, pieces and things from different jet engines. Gearbox from an A10 engine, J79 compressor cases. This is a J79 turbine. And let's take a little bit of a closer look at this to see the locking clips here. And then we'll look at the locking system of an LM2500 or CF6 disc, which I'm not sure if you can see, but we'll take a look at it in just a second. This is a lock strip for the first stage, and I'll give you a close-up of this in a second. This is a lock strip for the stage 3, and they've been bent up. They would look like almost like a big C channel when they're locked closed. Okay, amongst all the shiny bright clutter of Rolls-Royce parts, and it's clutter because Rolls-Royce engines have a lot more parts than other engines. Let's take a look at the lock tabs. I'm experimenting with manual focus here. Okay, so the stage 3, it's, I don't know, what is it? It's about a millimeter and a half thick metal, and it's been bent right there. It locks the blade in place, sort of holds it in place while it's not locking itself under operation. And there's the stage 1. So they're quite flexible. Sometimes they're stainless steel, sometimes they're like Inconel. But it's not really something that would hold the entire power and force of the engine. They are kind of flimsy from what you'd expect. And that's because of the way they work, as we explained with the Orenda in the shop. Okay, so now let's go take a look at the CF6 airliner engine, which is a very powerful engine. And okay, the spacer is missing. It's actually a seal that bolts on through every other hole, but you can see there's a spacer between the two discs right here. Okay, so there's the turbine rotor from a CF6, an airliner engine from the 70s. And actually, this is the back side. So that would be, this would be the second stage of the high pressure turbine. And down here would be the first stage. And it's kind of hard to see, but I've got some extra light here we're going to try to use. So we've got the spacer right there, is keeping the blades from moving rearward. And there's another seal that bolts right here that would lock them from moving forward, but it's not there because it's being used in an LM2500. The video on which is called, I think, Aircraft Turbine Land Engine, Big Power, something like that. Anyway, I found a first stage blade. Try to keep this in focus. Here we go. So it would face, based on the airfoil, would be going this way. So let's slide it into the slot. Slide it in there. And under its own weight, it won't fall out. As a matter of fact, I'm gonna use a tripod here, hang on. So if you can see, we've got the thing there. It just slides in, it's all been cleaned. And it goes in like that. If I push here, never coming out, never. If I push in the middle, it is a bit loose. I push here, nothing. If I push closer to the root, it might slide. Yeah, it does slide. Okay, so I'm pushing with about 30 pounds of force right there. No slidey. And if I just touch it here, it comes right out. So you get the phenomenon under operation. Look at that. Air cooling entrances and exits right there. You get the phenomenon of the rocking, the cocking, and the locking. Can you hear that? I'm hurting myself. There's no way it's going to move. It hasn't moved a millimeter. So all you need is a little bit of a security on either side of it so it doesn't rattle around during transit or earthquakes or something like that. Once the engine is, before it's even started burning fuel, they've locked into place. Very cool. Super high technology. Actually, this is from the 1960s. It's beautiful though, isn't it? It's beautiful. Okay, so that's what holds in your turbine blades in your jet engine. And on a quiet, rainy day from the high technology graveyard, actually, it's not a graveyard, is it really? It's more like the place where things have come to die, but maybe not to die. Maybe parts of them can be resurrected to be used again, depending on the whims of various forces that change from time to time. So what is this? This is turbine engine purgatory. Yeah. Thanks for watching.